Tonight, look who's back. Plus, I have an exclusive interview with a writer and director of one of this year's top thrillers and a show filled with a bevy of independent horror and sci-fi flicks. All that, plus a whole lot more for you. Tonight on Outtakes with Fiore. Greetings, salutations, and other sundry affair. I am your cinematic professor and purveyor of truth in movies. Hey, I'm very happy tonight to start the show off with an exclusive interview with Teddy Grennan. He is the writer and director of Ravage. A few shows back, I told you about Ravage. It's probably one of the better thrillers of this year. It starts out as a type of female Rambo movie, but then turns into a very gruesome torture flick. Good thrills and spills. And we talked about the movie and his founding of the Sun Valley Film Festival. So here for you now, an exclusive interview with Teddy Grennan.
Greetings, salutations, and other sundry affair. I am your cinematic professor and purveyor of truth in movies. And today I'm very happy to have with me the writer and director of the new thriller horror movie, Ravage. Please help me welcome Teddy Grennan. Teddy, this movie, I gotta tell you, it was a little disturbing. It really truly was. We have some very serious torture going on, and we have some cows. And apparently, the themes of cows and tortures are kind of there are a lot in your history. How did these two come together, and what brought them about into Ravage?
Well, thank you for having me on. I appreciate being part of it. I live in Central Virginia in Charlottesville, and I was driving around listening to a radio show, and there was a young cub reporter from NPR talking about the cattle and the ranching industry in Central Virginia. And they were going and on, and the young reporter asked the farmer about what the cattle could handle in regards to GMOs for the feed. And the farmer told the young reporter, he said, look, cows have four stomachs. It's one of the most toxic environments on the planet. A cow can handle anything. I thought, well, that's an interesting idea. So we kind of tied that into what you're referring to in the story. That was the initiation of it all.
Now, this thing went through a couple of title changes. Originally, you were going to call it Lord of Pain. And when you started debuting it on the film festival, it went under the name Swing Low. Now it's being released widely under Ravage. Why all these different name changes, and what was behind the switch?
It's not because of an identity crisis, but you've done your homework, haven't you?
I try.
the original title when I was Lord of Pain was an expression of the history that Bruce Dern speaks of, is the Lords of Pain, which are the European kings and queens, which, you know, is a big, as they say in the story, it's a big business. And it was kind of a respectful nod to that. And the money was raised initially as Lord of Pain. And then we changed it to Swing Low with kind of the Southern Gothic nature of it all, which we shot it in Virginia, like I said, and we wanted to have that. I think the whole idea, Swing Low, the idea of this person being delivered from an environment, you know, with the prophet Elijah, it was not a total thing, but also the familiarity of Swing Low in the South. The people that we partnered with that we're excited about, Brainstorm Media and VMI, Ravage was a better opportunity to kind of get in front of exactly what we were doing. You said it's a little heavy on the torture, which is probably true. We tried to be a little bit different with it in this round, but we felt that the Ravage spoke a little more loudly about what we were doing with the picture, or as we call it internally, Ravage.
Now, one of the things that I mentioned in my review is that there's probably nothing more horrifying than a viewer's imagination. And what I liked about Ravage was that it seems to me you could have gone the gore fest way and you could have shown a lot more, but especially in the final reels, you kind of brought everything up to a certain point and then let the viewer's imagination kind of fill in the rest. Did you do that intentionally, or was it just a matter of not wanting to get into all the prosthetics and everything?
So that's a great question. And in the first edit that we did, there's a lot of things that are left more to the imagination. When Harper gets off the line and she goes into the little closet and she finds the guy in there, we actually didn't initially show it. And because we wanted to leave it to people's imagination. And I think, like you said, that is scarier. And by no means do I make any comparison or similarity between our film, but I'm only mentioning this. And I mean this with total humility. But I think what happened in Rosemary's Baby, when you can't see her around the corner with the baby in her arms with Mia, like, that's terrifying. And that, I mean, I remember seeing that. I think that the viewer is a lot smarter and almost every case than the filmmaker anyhow, and what they can imagine is worse than what we can do on films. A lot of that was initially, a lot of it you didn't see in the first pass. And then we had, I'm also, I want to be sensitive towards our market. We had a bunch of knuckleheads down in Texas. We used to call Team Texas. And they're like, come on, man, show us the blood and guts. So, the motorcycle scene, I'll refer to it as that. What you see after that, that was not initially there either. Again, it was Team Texas saying, look, we get it, but we want to have a little more fun. And I you want to walk that line also. It is, you have people that want a little more, and it was fun also doing it. But I also found, this genre, we've been referring, it is a horror for sure, but we've been trying to refer to it as a bloody thriller. And in respect to that, I think I think just like what you said, is there's so much available to your imagination that we can't do anyway, and it's more horrific in a lot of ways. So we really produce this in respect to that.
Well, I really enjoyed this movie, and I think a lot of people will climb along with me. Teddy, I want to swing to a different road here, if you will. You're also the founder of the Sun Valley Film Festival. And this is something that's been going on, what, 8-9 years now?
Yeah, we're in our 10th year.
A 10th year. Now, I know that it was canceled this year because of the, just like everything else with the flu and the virus. Are you still going to come back with this thing and still run it?
We are. We've got the opportunity, we've got some time until March. If everything is ready to go at that point, meaning safety, and we can have, one of the things that's been a real pleasure about the working for the film festival is that we have a lot of people that are, older than 50 that come, and it's an honor for us to have these people and entertain them. So we're very sensitive to that, as you can possibly imagine. Well, we're sensitive to it for a lot of reasons, but we will be back next March. If it's the right thing to do. We canceled the festival right before the festival led right up to it. It was a very tough decision in a lot of ways, we're becoming a respectful economic impact to the community. So, it's over $5 million annually. And so we had to unplug a lot. The festival is only 5 days, but it takes us 10 and a half months to set it up. It's a big front load of production. So there are a lot of commitments there that, we had to honor in different ways, and that took a lot. The joke is, it's hard enough to launch a film festival annually. It's even harder to shut it down or to cancel it. Actually, is the real word is to cancel it, and it's disappointing for a lot of people. So, but thank you for asking. That was a hell of a year.
Yeah. Do you think you'll be able to kick it up again, or do you think you'll have to, like, start working and dragging it all up again?
We are going to do it again. I was saying we're going to do it in March next year if we're allowed, if it looks good. If not, we will push it forward a little bit. But the festival will be back in 2021 with hopefully a lot of things in America, in the world.
Yeah. Now, I saw something online that stated, and this might be wrong, so, you know, because you can't believe everything on the on the internet, but it said to help finance the film Ravage, you went and sold your Jaguars. Now, if that's true, you know, kudos for having a couple of Jaguars to sell, because what I'm getting here is apparently you were kind of a rebel rouser. I read that you were like tossed out of two prep schools, or I shouldn't say tossed out. I should probably say asked to leave politely out of a couple of schools. And then the next thing you know, you're running this film festival and you've got Ravage under your belt. There's got to be something that happened between getting kicked out of the prep schools and becoming, you know, the co-founder to this festival. So fill in a little bit of that gap there for our viewers, will you?
It's simple. I truly married the right woman. I mean it, actually. I'm not even trying to be funny. I married the right woman, and the Jaguars were my neighbors that I had bought I turned 50 last year. I was getting there. It was the year I was born. I thought it was kind of these cool cars. We actually use them in the film. It's the car that Annabelle Dexter Jones tries to start after she's leaving Mallinckrodt, Bruce Dern's house, and it doesn't start. And then you see another one in red as she's leaving with this kind of trail of cars. If you notice, she's driving the blue Land Rover, and then she passes the red Jaguar. It's an E420. And then as she keeps going down the road, she passes another red Land Rover. So kind of, and then her car, as you know, and this is not a spoiler alert because everybody knows the cars always break down. And she runs out of gas actually on that. So it's kind of this littered trail of people trying to escape from this valley. Yes, and I thought that I would keep those Jags after the film, and I ended up selling them for post. We had a couple of things that we wanted to do in the post-production, including the bookends to the film that we hadn't budgeted. So I sold them, and I sold them to a friend of mine, a guy in Charlottesville. He still has one of them.
Nice. Now, what is your best hope here for Ravage? I know there's still a lot of theaters that are not open, so it doesn't get that kind of a push. And you really got to rely on streaming devices and VOD. Are you comfortable with that for this movie?
Yeah, I mean, you know, it was supposed to screen tonight down in Southern Virginia at a drive-in, and it's getting rained out. We've got really wild weather here right now. Mm. I think that people have become so nuanced, used to watching, you know, everyone's been in their house under a roof for the last several months. I think with what Brainstorm's going to do and what VMI is doing the release of it, I think it'll get a I think it'll do well on the streaming. They're a great trailer, and it was funny because you can tell the story pretty quickly in there, but yeah, I hope that people really identify with Annabelle Dexter Jones, who just made this film. I didn't have anything to do with it, you know. I had a great cinematographer, an extraordinary actor who was kind and her patience with me as a first-time director. And obviously I had a great crew. And then there's Robert Longstreet and Bruce Dern, and those guys everybody was very kind to me. Everyone was really patient. You know, I mean, I had a good idea of what I wanted, but you don't always know that. And these guys have been doing it their whole lives. I haven't. I've produced a bit, but really getting in there and you know, pointing out what I needed was, I learned a lot from those guys. So, hopefully people will identify with it.
Well, you have a little background in animation too, don't you?
I do. I worked for Nickelodeon and right. Oh, you're talking about the cow thing. That was where your comment earlier. You really have done your homework, haven't you? That's hilarious. Yeah. And that's kind of the funny thing you picked up on that is that, yes, I guess I have a thing for cows, but I don't eat them anymore. I eat Impossible Burger, which I love. We did a taste choice with the kids, and they picked the Impossible Burger. I was thrilled.
Oh, my. Well, I know you're really, focused now on Ravage, and certainly I wish you a lot of luck with it because I enjoyed the film immensely. But dare I ask, what is on your future plate coming down the pike as far as movies are concerned?
So if I'm really lucky, I'm going to shoot a film next year here in Virginia. It's a story totally, totally different. It's about a woman who is reawoken when a boy more or less ends up on her farm. He's witnessed a murder and basically fallen in the back of her turnip truck. She's, a farmer and goes into the cities to the farmer market. He witnesses this murder, jumps in the back, and he's got to stay with her for a week as a bad cop so it's this kind of blind side meets witness. And then, if I'm lucky, we're going to start shooting that next year. I have a tiny little bloody thriller that we're trying to, we have a start date of next month, which I was telling you a little bit. We were scouting in Pennsylvania. It's called 911, and it's a revenge thriller. A woman realizes she's playing this game with these boys on this kid's family farm. It's called 911. What's your emergency?
Nice. Very nice. Teddy, I wish you an awful lot of luck with Ravage. I enjoyed the film immensely. And I know for sure that there's an audience out there for it. It's just a matter of getting people, to know it's there and to see it. I certainly will do my part. I appreciate you taking the time out of your busy day to join us on the show. Best of luck with Ravage.
Thank you very much. It was a complete pleasure.
Thanks to Teddy Grennan for stopping by and granting us that interview. Ravage, it's a good movie. We'll keep track of his future endeavors, pass them along to you as we get word. The title of the movie is called Good Things Devils Do. I don't understand this title because there's a vampire in it. It has nothing to do with devils. And they went out and got three pretty big names for horror films. Kane Hodder is in this, Leonard Quigley is in this, and Bill Oberst Jr. is. Oh, you got three names like that. You got to figure, hey, this is going to be pretty. No, it's not. It's not. In fact, Kane gets out of the movie after about the first 12 minutes and says, that's it, I'm done. And that's probably a wise move. This has some really, really cheesy dialogue. The audio mix is totally off on this. The first half hour of the movie, the musical soundtrack is louder than the actors doing the part. It's what an absolute mess. I think it might have had something to do with the equipment that they were using on this. But the bottom line is, this movie just didn't cut the mustard. Here's a look at the good things devils do.
Are you going to do a show this year?
I promise I will have something for you. Something that just might be the prize piece of my entire collection. I call her Masquerade.
The Holly brothers, we're very happy that you decided to help them, Richard.
I've earned the right to walk away on my own terms.
Of course you have.
And I don't want him around my daughter.
I ordered the remains of a vampire.
We wouldn't be in this situation if you'd open the door!
She did things that are physically impossible to do. Girl out there, it's a real vampire.
Stand, you gotta fight it!
That's a really cool costume.
Il demonio della mascherata. The demon of the masquerade.
Go!
Yeah, she looks all innocent now. She's gonna grow up to be just like you.
You know, one of the things that's been very consistent through all of the different machinations of the Wuhan virus is House of Faruza Barbershop and Cigar Lounge. You know what I like about this place? When you become a member, you get your own locker. This is really cool because you can, you know, it's locked. You got your own combination. You can put your stuff in there, leave it there for every time you come back in. It's a way of making the club even more personal than what it is. And that's on top of all the fine cigars and libations and gaming boards and what have you that you can do down there. It's a great place to belong and a great place to be, and you can style and profile while you're there too. It's House of Faruza Barbershop and Cigar Lounge. It's right there on the corner of South Park Road and Drake Road in Bethel Park. Stop by today, see Sam, tell him I sent you. He'll take real good care of you. I told you before, in fact, many times, that I really enjoy horror anthologies. The reason is, if you get a story in there that's maybe kind of cheesy and not that scary, you got a chance for other stories to kind of make up for it. And this one is a horror anthology. It's called A Night of Horror, Nightmare Radio. The Nightmare Radio story is the story that kind of bookends all the other stories. Folks, this movie is 90 minutes long, and they put 8 different stories in here. It's kind of clever the way they do it. Some of the stories are shorter than the end credits. Strange Dave is in this. I mention him because I've mentioned him in independent horror films before. He plays a small role called the Smiling Man, but it's a role that you will remember. This movie is about 50-50. I think 4 of the stories are okay, but 4 of them are pretty decent. Here's a look at Night of Horror, Nightmare.
This is a very special night. There's a heavy storm.
I'm Rod Wilson, and on this stormy night, we are going to tell horror stories.
There's a dark, dark house.
And in that dark, dark house, there was a dark, dark room.
Have you ever gotten lost in the forest? Did you ever see something strange? Well, strap in. Don't touch that dial. The show must go on.
Okay, I think everybody knows somebody like this. They live, breathe, and die for gaming. That's it. That's their life. Caitlin, you know anyone like that? Mm-hmm. Yeah? A lot of people like that? Okay, there you go. See? So my point to this is that if you're one of those people, I think you're going to be heavily offended by this next movie. I really do. Because it's really ripping on you. And the biggest ripper of all is Kevin Smith, of all people. Yeah. But if you're not one of those people, if gaming is just, you know, something to do when you have downtime and you can take everything about gaming with a grain of salt, then you might find some laughs in Max Reload and the Nether Blasters. Here's a look.
You tell us what the hell is going on here.
You're Eugene Wilder.
Yeah, the one and only. And you are Max, right?
I know it sounds nuts. I mean, I've been wanting to play this game since I could hold a controller.
I knew he'd be back. I just had no idea there were any game cartridges left. I knew it was only a matter of time before the Harbinger found his one player, the one man capable of truly unlocking.
My boy, chosen one.
Chosen pawn. Pawn, chosen pawn, and we're not even sure. Maybe. Imagine hundreds, if not thousands, of nether-possessed game junkies like your friend here, just running through the streets, running amok.
It's up to us to stop it.
This is like a movie!
You know, I honestly hate to see a good monster go to waste. And there's a pretty good monster in this movie. It's called the Faceless Man. And the Faceless Man, of course, is the monster. He's not in it nearly enough. And everything that surrounds him is absolutely nonsensical. There are stories happening in this movie that have no cohesive glue to tie them together. In fact, I'll tell you how bizarre it is. The lead character is killed. And then without any explanation, she shows up in the next scene. And this happens twice. Okay? This movie is an absolute joke. It's called The Faceless Man.
Is there anything that I can help you with?
You want to help me? You know, it was just supposed to be me and you going away this weekend.
This is a good town with good people.
This is Charlie Lamont's house. Who are you?
Edward Silverbeard, but you can call me Eddie. Whatever you do, don't go into the workshop. This is what happens when you bring drugs into my house.
This is what happens when you bring drugs into my town!
In our search for movies, we have traveled the four corners of the earth, but very seldom do we hear something from Russia. Ah, tonight we have one, and it's a good one. This one is called Sputnik, and it is a sci-fi monster yarn. Now, alien monster, if you will, but it's a good one. Good special effects in this, and the story is good. Yes, you're going to have to read it, but it's okay. Because the dialogue, English dialogue, is at the bottom. Big, huge, yellow letters. You can't miss it. And you'll be able to keep your eye on the action and still read the subtitles. Everything works out good. I like this one. It had an awful lot of familiar themes to it, but it's still a really good story. I think you're going to like this one, too. And it's a great way to end the show. Here's a look at Sputnik.
Судя по всему, на орбите произошел некий инцидент.
От меня-то что требуется?
Семирадов, моя фамилия. Требуется ваша консультация.
Зачем они меня задержат? Можете объяснить?
Сразу вам все расскажу.
Well, you can tell by the bear at my side that we are all out of time, and it's time for us to skedaddle. Want to say thanks once again to Teddy Grennan for stopping by our Outtakes cameras, and good luck with his movie, Ravage. Also want to say thanks to Caitlin, who joined our crew today. She'll be with us for a while. You know, all of the movies that you've heard about here, you can see my video capsule critiques on the official Outtakes with Fiore YouTube channel. Here's the URL for that below. And you can read my written reviews on the official Outtakes with Fiore blog. Now that you have learned what you have learned, here endeth your lesson.